Everybody, and I'd like to say I'm glad to be up here, but this is a bit of a struggle at times for me since I'm relatively new at it, and I'm always amazed at our pastor how easy he makes it look. So I'm just, some of us have gifts and some of us don't. So anyway, my message today is going to be about discernment, and I'm going to give you some examples of discernment problems that existed in churches, and then we're going to learn how to maybe overcome some of these discernment problems. So I'm going to give you a personal example of learning discernment. I grew up in a bakery family, and that in itself is sort of unusual because when you work in a small business, the entire family is involved in the small business, whether you want to be there or not. And so, always around Thanksgiving and Christmas time, what happens is you work hours. You'll work 12, 15 hours a day, two or three days in a row. And so when the holiday shows up, you're too tired to enjoy it. So, but anyway, in the bakery business, I started working at a pretty young age at 11, and so my dad would give us different jobs to learn and stuff. And I pretty much stayed in that position until I left for college. But working in a bakery requires you to judge and discern things. And so when I say that, I mean you're making a food product that people eat, so it's got to look good and it's got to taste right. So you learn the art of discernment by doing things and by trial and error, and you didn't want to make too many errors because your dad would get mad at you. So one of the things that there were several things that I would do. I would fry donuts, I would run the oven baking things, and then other odd jobs as my dad gave them to me. But when you fry donuts, you have a big screen about like that, and you have maybe 20 or 30 donuts on it. And so you have a fryer, and you have a handle, and you pick them up, and you put it on the fryer. And so, and you had a long stick, and you would watch those donuts, and now and then you would flip one to see what color it is. And so you didn't want it too dark, you didn't want it too light. And the other thing is you wanted both sides to be the same color. And so you learn the art, you learn to discern carefully what was going on there. Running an oven was the same way. You would look at products. You'd open the door, it would be pretty hot, 400 degrees. But you look at the coffee cake or the cookies or whatever cakes were being baked at that time, so you would check the color to make sure it was fine. So, and then if you talk too much like I did, because being 15 years old, sometimes I would just run my mouth and not pay attention. And then I end up burning some stuff in the oven, and I caught hell for that. So, and another job that I had there was whipping cream. And so in the afternoon, we would do the cream products, the cream puffs, the eclairs, and that kind of stuff. So you would whip cream so you could use it in the product. And so once again, if you weren't paying attention and discerning properly, you end up turning the whipping cream into butter. And then you would catch hell again. So anyway, that's in the bakery business, that's discerning your products and stuff. So, but what does discernment mean to Christians? And so discernment is the ability to see the truth and to tell the difference between truth and error. And so nowadays there's a lot of changes going on out there that the churches are working their way through. There are cultural issues. There's just a variety of things that are happening. And some of them are good and some of them are bad. But I wanted to give you a couple of examples of what our church, when I say, I should say historically, what the church has gone through and working out different problems. They learn to discern properly. So let's take a look at an example of the Galatians. Galatia was a Roman province that was located in what is today Turkey. And so the Apostle Paul had written a letter to them because the church was facing a theological crisis. The church was primarily a Jewish Gentile church, and what was happening was some were in the church were attempting to integrate the Jewish law back into what the Christians were practicing there. And so in other words, they wanted to teach justification by works. And so they would require the new converts that were male to be circumcised, and that was one of the problems that that Paul was trying to teach and get them around. So Paul's purpose in writing to these churches was to reestablish the teaching on justification, to properly discern what justification was. So let's read in Galatians 1, 6 through 8. I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel, which is not another, but there are some who would trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we have already preached, let him be accursed. And so Paul was surprised to hear about these changes and stuff, and so he wrote his letter to get them back on track. And so moving up to today, we see other discernment problems that some of the churches are having. The nature of the Trinity, or the nature of God and the Trinity, is a complex subject. And so you see over the years that some churches struggle with that, trying to understand it. Now, today, mostly the Catholic and Protestant churches have a good view of it and stuff, and they understand it properly. But there are some who still struggle with it. And so in the third century, there was a concept put forth called modalism. And what the author was trying to do was to get a handle on it. But it was the incorrect handle. And so what modalism is they would teach that there was one God. And so they're trying to keep in line with what was being taught in the Old Testament church. But what they were teaching was there was one God, and he would take different positions. He would be God the Father, and then he would be God the Son, and then he would be God the Holy Spirit. And so what he was, it was just one God. And so the concept of modalism was incorrect. And so today, what we're taught is the Trinity. And the Trinity was something that was worked out by Tertullian and Augustine. In other words, they properly got a handle on it. And so what it is the Trinity is one God, one essence, three different personages. And so that's a concept of properly discerning what the truth is and what isn't. And so there's also another type of problem that plagues churches today, and that's salvation by works. And so that's the teaching that a person can work their way to heaven. And I guess it's easy to get confused on that whole issue, but they believe that by praying and doing good works, by keeping the commandments, they can work their way to heaven. And so that's, of course, not the case. When I was out passing tracks over the American River, I had a Russian student come up to me, and he only had one question for me, and he said, "Do you teach salvation by works or by grace?" And it caught me flat-footed because I didn't know how to answer just right off. But then it occurred to me. I said, "Well, no." I said, explained to him in a quick response: grace alone, through faith alone, through Christ alone. And so it's not by works, it's by God's grace, it's by his mercy to us. And so anyway, today, like I said, that there are some Christians who are sort of enticed by salvation by works. They can see that they can control their own destiny and stuff. But again, as I said, salvation is through grace alone, through faith alone, and Christ alone. So let's take a look at Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. I get a little water here. It says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one can boast." So it's very clear that God extends his salvation to us. He is sovereign, and he gives that to us by his grace. So anyway, I think what happens with a lot of people, the reason why they get sort of tripped up by this is because sometimes they'll look at rewards. And so there is a concept in the Bible called rewards. And of course, what that teaches is basically that we're rewarded in heaven I guess the best way to describe it is how much we love God, how close we are to him, how much we serve him, those kind of things. And those are rewards that has nothing to do with salvation alone. So anyway, let's see. One more story about the bakery here in Discernment. In the bakery, we were always learning how to do different things. And so one of the things that we were taught was how to make bread. And so that's always sort of a tough task because we had this 75-quart mixer. And so in this mixer, we would end up with, I don't know, 100 pounds of dough. And so what we would have to do is get that bowl and that dough up on the table and then cut it into like 100 different pieces, 1-pound pieces and stuff. And so I would work with my dad, my brother would be there, and we would cut up all the pieces and make sure they weighed correctly. The problem I always had was actually making the bread itself, the shape. And so my dad would slam the dough down, and I'd watch him, and he'd stretch it, fold it over and roll it, and it would be a perfect loaf. I would try it, and it would be oblong. It would be weird shaped and stuff, and I think he must have thought there was something wrong with me. So, but anyway, again, discerning properly how to do things in a bakery. And so, anyway, let's sort of get to the of learning how to discern properly. And so the heart of discernment is being able to distinguish the ways of the world from the ways of God. And so we want to make sure that we see things correctly, and we'll always use the Bible to discern properly. One of the things that a lot of us don't think about, but it's true, that Satan is always working overtime to mislead us. He'll always do what he can to lie to us and to get us off on the wrong track. And so there's a lot of different, as I had already given two examples of problems that come into churches. And so, but the way you get around this is we need to read and study our Bible. It's God's work to us. And so knowing the Bible teaches us to stay close to God and not to be blown about by false doctrine. And so I'm going to give you another example here in the church with the book of Hebrews. The book of Hebrews is an interesting book. It was written by they don't know who to someone they don't know who. And so what happens is there's been a lot of arguments as to why the book of Hebrews was written and to who it was written. Some say that Paul wrote it. For the sake of argument, let's just say Paul wrote it. And so he was writing it to a Christian church that was in trouble. It was either in Palestine or perhaps in Asia Minor. And so the general purpose of this epistle was to preserve those whom were in danger of apostasy. And so they were in the process of basically falling away. And so let's read Hebrews real quick here. Hebrews 5:11 through 14. We have much to say about this, but it is hard to make clear to you because you no longer try to understand. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But the solid food for those who, for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. And so that's the key right there at the end, to distinguish good from evil. And so there's different types of apostasy, and one type is falling away from true doctrine, from the Bible, and the other is just falling away from the faith. And so I think in this situation here with the Hebrews, it was probably a little bit of both, but primarily falling away from true doctrines. It could have been that they were slowly being assimilated back into local Jewish faith and renouncing Christ and the gospel. But it's hard to say. But what Paul was saying to them was, is you no longer care and you should be further along in your understanding of truth. And so the keys to this passage is becoming skilled in the Word of God. And when I say that, I mean by constant practice. And so reading your Bible on a regular basis does help. I usually get up pretty early in the morning and read the Bible when I can. Sometimes I get lazy. But read your Bible and basically use that as a measuring stick against everything that that you hear and that you read about, especially when it comes to being in anything to do with church and stuff. So the truth can distinguish, the Bible can distinguish truth from error. So that's important. So anyway, that's my message today. Thank you. And why don't we pray real quick here? Most holy Father, thank you for giving us the opportunity to learn and to listen. Thank you, Father, for the chance to fellowship with one another and to encourage one another. And thank you, most holy Father, for just the words you give us, the songs that we can sing, and the fellowship that happens here, Father. It means so much to us. It helps us to go through the week, Father, and to endure what the world gives us. So thank you, most holy Father.